Good morning, and thank you very much for inviting me to this important event on artificial intelligence. My name is Lucilla Scioli. I'm Director for Artificial Intelligence and Digital Industry at the European Commission, and I have been working on the policy for artificial intelligence now since 2018. And since we started to think about AI, we immediately decided, and this is very clear in the first communication of the European Commission, that the objective of our policy is about making Europe a leading hub in artificial intelligence and making sure that those developments in artificial intelligence are actually trustworthy and human-centric. And so we have been working with a high-level expert group who has developed guidelines for artificial intelligence and a set of key principles. We have been working and presented a white paper which undertook a very wide public consultation in which we identified the importance of developing in the European Union an ecosystem of excellence or a list of measures in support of research and innovation in AI, as well as an ecosystem of trust to make sure that businesses and citizens actually use the technology. In fact, we think the technology is extremely important, and we have seen it also during the COVID crisis and the very different ways in which artificial intelligence has been used, both for reading CT scan images or for predicting the way people were migrating and moving around the European Union, in particular during the first wave of the disease, or being used with supercomputers to search for the vaccines or for treatments for COVID. So it is really the versatility of artificial intelligence that makes it very special as a technology and very useful for our society and economies. And because of that, we want businesses and citizens to use artificial intelligence as much as possible. To do that, we need to address the issue of trust. And that's what we like to do with our regulatory framework, which was published yesterday. And I'm very happy to be here and present it for the first time to you as a very prestigious audience of experts in this topic. The presentation is a little bit complex, and therefore I will be using a set of slides to help me. Artificial intelligence is going to be crucial to the shaping of our digital future. And as I said, it is good for citizens, for business, for the public interest. We have many, many different applications of artificial intelligence. But we also know that artificial intelligence may create risks. And the risks we are thinking about are mostly risks in terms of violating our fundamental rights or violating our safety standards, which we have achieved as a society after a long time. And many of these rights are actually enshrined in the Charter for Fundamental Rights. Now, when we were writing the regulatory framework with the objective of minimizing the potential of these risks, we had to come up with a definition of artificial intelligence. And this was a very complex, this is a very complex exercise in a legal text. And also we had to keep in mind all the time that this is a technology, it's a technology that changes over time. And therefore that we needed to find solutions as well as legislative solutions to make this framework adapted to a very dynamic system. Therefore, we opted for a definition of artificial intelligence, which is very much based on the OECD definition of artificial intelligence. We think this definition is large enough to be future-proof. And we also include in the annex a list of techniques that would be captured by this definition. And this is going to be very important to be able to give legal certainty to the developers and those who will be addressed by requirements in this legislation. We have always been told that we had to be very careful in not stifling innovation. We know that very well. It's a technology, it's a very innovative technology. And our way of being proportionate with our legislative intervention is to be able to very much focus on a limited number of applications of artificial intelligence that are really creating risk. And so we have developed the concept of taking a risk-based approach, which of course called for us to be able to define risk. First of all, we have built a pyramid of different levels of risk. Most of the market, in our opinion, is of artificial intelligence applications that carry no risk, and therefore that will have no obligations under the current proposal. Then we have some applications that, in our opinion, require some transparency obligations. We are thinking in particular, for example, chatbots that need to identify themselves as such to users, in particular when it is not obvious and users may misunderstand. Then we have a category of high-risk applications. Here, this is what the regulation mostly focuses on, and it refers both to applications that are of artificial intelligence that are embedded in products, for example, in medical devices, or artificial intelligence systems that are not embedded in products. We call them very often the standalone systems, and which come under mostly software forms, let's say, like recruitment or other kind of similar software applications. And on top of the pyramid, we have unacceptable risk. Here we have a list of prohibitions that are contained, if you're following the framework, very much in Article 5. And we identify areas where we would like to prohibit the use of artificial intelligence. This has to deal very much with the use of, for example, subliminal manipulation, which may result in physical or psychological harm of the user. Or we refer to artificial intelligence systems that are used to exploit children or mentally disabled people, and also this resulting in physical or psychological harm. We would like to prohibit the use of artificial intelligence to public authorities with a view to implement a general purpose of social scoring. And we would like to prohibit biometric identification use by law enforcement in public accessible spaces. Now, for this last item on biometric identification, I will come back to that at a later slide, because, you know, biometrics is a very specific application in the context of this proposal. And I will come back to that later, because this foresees some exceptions. We have identified and we have proposed a certain way of identifying risk. This is very much based on the impact that a risky application may have, either because it impacts on many people or because it is of, you know, the impact is difficult to reverse. For example, if you have a physical accident and then you are going to, you know, you are going to have to go to undertake treatment, it's not something that you can just forget about, or because it's a risk that is very likely to happen. And looking at the evidence we had of violations of rights of artificial intelligence systems, we've come up with a list of areas where we think the most of the use cases that can be risky from the point of view of our proposal may fall in. And you can see in this slide the list of the areas. They include, as I said, biometric identification, operation and management of critical infrastructure, education, employment, access to private and public services, law enforcement, migration, asylum and border control management, and administration of justice. So these are areas in which we have identified specific use cases, and these use cases can be found in title in the annexes, in particular in Annex 3. In order for us to be able to have a dynamic proposal that can take into account of use cases that emerge over time, we have also introduced the possibility to amend Annex 3 through delegated acts, which are a faster way to update a piece of legislation compared to the full review of the legislation, but which is a way of updating a legislation which can only be taking place in a specific set of the part of that legislation. And so for us, it will only be the list of use cases and through the governance system that we would like to implement through this regulation, we would like to be able to update the list of use cases. If you're interested in the full list, please go to Annex 3 of the proposal. What do we want to do, really? What we want to do is that we would like these use cases to be undertaking a process which is very similar or actually equivalent to the CE marking process. CE marking is a process which is very much valid in the European Union and which normally concerns goods and products that are placed on the European market and that are needed to be checked because of their safety implications. So for the lawyers, I would say this is very much an internal market approach, and it is very much based on European product legislation. And what happens in a CE marking is that the products would have to undertake a conformity assessment before they're actually being placed on the market or being placed in service. And that this conformity assessment will make sure that the design and the development and the quality management system are in place. Once the conformity assessment procedure is over, then the product can be put on the European market and then can be used throughout the European market. And they will have a CE marking sign that will prove to the user that the product has undertaken this process. Now, what do we want to check in this conformity assessment? We want to check some obligations which are actually very much based on the principles that had been identified by the high-level expert group, and they concern the quality of the data sets in terms of the training, the validation, and the testing data sets. We would like the systems to be well documented, in particular the choice made by the designer or the developer in terms of the parameters used and also the design of login features. And this is going to be very important to ensure the traceability and the auditability in the future. We would like to have a certain degree of transparency either for certain applications like the chatbot that I mentioned earlier, but also in terms of the information that a developer has to provide to the user of the system. This information will have to document, for example, the accuracy of the system, the conditions under which the system can be used or cannot be used, but also the kind of human oversight that should be applied to that particular system, because it will be very much under the responsibility of the user to implement the human oversight system that the artificial intelligence under consideration actually needs. And therefore, if we look at the obligation of the operators, we are going to have most of the obligation on the side of the provider of the artificial intelligence systems. The operator will have to put in place a quality management system. It will have to draw up the technical documentation. It will have to document its login obligations. It will have to undertake the conformity assessment. In the conformity assessment, in particular for the standalone artificial intelligence system, we will ask the providers to register themselves in a database that the commission and the system, the governance system in place, will be able to monitor. They will have to affix the CE marking system, and also in case there are problems, once the system is put on the market, then they will have to deal with the appropriate authorities. This is because this ex-ante system mostly aims at making sure that the artificial intelligence system that is placed on the market actually works. And it can minimize the risk, but it can never completely delete or cancel those risks. So there is still a certain harm that could reproduce itself once the system is put in the market. But when that happens, there will be an authority that will check whether that harm is due to the fact that the provider has not taken the appropriate steps to minimize the risk or not. If it is not the case, of course, there is no consequence for the provider of the artificial intelligence system. Also, the user will have some obligation, but this is a limited set of obligations. In fact, we will expect the user to actually follow the instructions of use to, as I said earlier, implement the human oversight processes that have been proposed by the provider, and also monitor and inform in case a harm takes place and there is a possibility to check that harm is taking place. And of course, the legal obligations that apply under the General Data Protection Regulation in the case of personal processing of personal data will continue to apply. So, in essence, if we see at what will happen when one of those risky artificial intelligence systems will have to be put in the market, first, the provider will have to make sure that the system is in line with the five requirements explained earlier, undertake the ex-ante conformity assessment. In case of trouble, once the artificial intelligence system is in the market, there will be an authority that will be able to check what was done in the conformity assessment. And also, in case the system continues to learn, or in case that for any reason there is any significant change to the artificial intelligence system once it's placed on the market, then a new conformity assessment will have to be undertaken. Let me now come to the remote biometric identification, which is probably the special case, I would say, of the artificial intelligence systems we have under consideration, also because here we have a little bit of a different approach, although we think that the remote biometric identification systems will have to undertake an ex-ante conformity assessment. On top of that, we have to distinguish between the use of real-time remote biometric identification systems for purposes of law enforcement to the case where the systems are actually being used ex post. In the case of real time, and in the case of real time by law enforcement, as I said, Article 5 stipulates a prohibition with a number of exceptions. These exceptions relate to the fact that the law enforcement authorities are looking for victims, or there is a threat to life or the danger and the risk of terrorism, or that there is a serious crime has been committed, and by serious crime we mean the crimes that are listed in the European arrest warrant. So there is a list of 32 serious crimes listed there. And so we would like that list to be the reference list for the crimes for which the use of real-time system is actually allowed. So there will be the need of an authorization, and then the law enforcement authorities will be able to use artificial intelligence for the use of systems. Let me be very clear here. We are not saying that we are going to need all this. That this corresponds to the setting up and the use of cameras in the street. This is really the use of artificial intelligence systems, in particular when the artificial intelligence is actually looking for people to match with a reference database or a watch list. So in this case, the artificial intelligence systems cannot be used when the police is looking for specific people in real time, simply because it is very invasive and it can have a significant impact on people's life if law enforcement authority stop people just because there is a suspicion that they could be matching the watch list. It is possible for the law enforcement authorities to do so only when they're looking for a criminal and we're in the presence of a very serious crime. And in this case, in any case, we know that the artificial intelligence systems, at least at the current state of technology, can make mistakes and that these mistakes can have very important consequences. So it is very important that the ex-ante third-party conformity assessment takes place. I've been talking about law enforcement authorities. It doesn't mean that the prohibition is only for law enforcement authorities. Here, legally speaking, for the private use of artificial intelligence systems is already prohibited, and it is prohibited by the GDPR, with some exceptions. So, but in this case, we consider GDPR Article 9 to apply. Now, most AI systems, as I said at the very beginning, will not be high risk. And there will be the necessity to introduce some transparency obligations for making sure that the user knows he's dealing with an artificial intelligence system. This is in the case of the chatbots, this is the case of deepfakes, or also in the case of emotional recognition, on the use of emotional recognition systems, where the user needs to be informed that he's dealing with an artificial intelligence system that is using emotional recognition. And then for the cases of minimal or no risk, we also invite industry associations, for example, to put in place voluntary codes of conduct. This is going to help developers of artificial intelligence also to have a certain reflection about the use that is made of the data, the use that is made, and the possible usages in the future, and the how intrusive these uses can be. So I think this is going to be voluntary, but if it could also be used, for example, to flag that the artificial intelligence in question does not use a lot of energy or didn't use a lot of energy in its training session, or other similar messages that want to be given to the user about the artificial intelligence. And we will also include some items to support innovation. For example, we will be introducing or proposing regulatory sandboxes, as well as a specific support for SMEs and startups. In the governance structure, we will be working very closely with member states, and member states will be choosing the national authorities that will monitor the implementation of the system on the market, the so-called market surveillance authorities, and they will choose them according to the sectors in which the artificial intelligence is deployed. But then at the European level, we need to ensure consistency, and therefore we'll set up an artificial intelligence board made of representatives of the national competent authorities, representatives of the European Commission, as well as of the data protection authority supervisor. We will be helped by an expert group, a sort of an advisory group, representing different parts of society, industry, and also, of course, academics. And we will need help, in particular, in identifying the impact the artificial intelligence is doing and whether there are new use cases or whether there are recommendations that need to be made in the implementation of this system. Because, first of all, we have to keep in mind that now there will be discussions with Parliament and the Council, and these discussions will be quite long. After that, we'll have a transition period, so there will be plenty of time to make sure that this proposal is actually tailored to the needs of the market. One last word about the fact that the package on artificial intelligence that we published yesterday also included a very important other document, which is the coordinated plan on artificial intelligence. This is an update of a plan we published in 2018, and we have tried to look at the lessons learned from the previous experience, and we have put forward new actions in artificial intelligence. What is new now? Well, many things. First of all, the fact that we're coming out of the pandemic, and so artificial intelligence is now playing new roles, in particular in healthcare, but not only in healthcare. The fact that we have Green Deal objectives now that we want to achieve, and so we want to maximize the use of AI also with that objective. The fact that we have new resources available, the Recovery and Resilience Fund that the Member States are preparing to use, 20% of that has to go in digital, and therefore we expect some of that funding to go to artificial intelligence. And the fact that there are new technological developments also on the side of infrastructure and in terms of hardware. And so we have based ourselves to come forward with key policy objectives for our policy. First of all, we want to set the enabling conditions in terms of increasing the access to data, in terms of making sure that we have an appropriate infrastructure in place, both from the point of view of the cloud infrastructure, but also from the point of view of our computing capabilities. Secondly, we want to continue to collaborate with stakeholders. We're in the process of setting up a new public-private partnership on AI, data, and robotics. And we want to strengthen our research capabilities, whether they're industrial research or whether they're foundational research, through our networks of excellence, for example. We will be accelerating innovation from the lab to the market through a new instrument that we call testing experimentation facilities. These are facilities where we would like developers of AI to go and test the innovation in AI, and also probably proposing also some regulatory sandboxes in the context of those testing experimentation facilities. And we will be using the network of European digital innovation hubs to help SMEs uptake AI. We, of course, want to make sure that technologies work for people. So I spoke at length about the ecosystem of trust, but there will also be a need to make sure that we have the appropriate skills, both in terms of the talent that we need to be able to retain in Europe, and that we need to be able to diversify. Otherwise, our AI will always tend to be biased. And on the other hand, we need to train the professionals. We need to train the lawyers, we need to train the doctors, we need to train all those people who will be using artificial intelligence so that they know what they're using. They will not need to program it, but they will need to understand how it works. And finally, we need to use this proposal to build our strategic leadership internationally, but also tapping on our great potential in our industrial sectors, in the sectors where artificial intelligence can make a big difference, as the green, the environmental sectors, healthcare. We want to be able to become much stronger in robotics. We are strong now, but we want to strengthen that strength, in particular with AI-enabled robots. We want our public sector to use AI, and of course, including in our industrial strengths in terms of mobility, but also in agriculture, where AI is really going to make a big difference. And of course, we have the Recovery and Resilience Fund, but we also have Horizon Europe, and we have the Digital Europe Program, which will be supporting a number of these actions. So I can only invite you to look at our package. We have a communication that explains all the different parts of the package, and we know that the proposal of the regulatory framework will raise a lot of discussions, and there will be those who think we didn't go far enough with the fundamental rights, and others will think that we are stifling innovation. We have tried to make a balanced approach, an approach that we think should not distort innovation, and that we think it's proportionate to the defense of our fundamental rights and our safety standards, which is the main objective we have. So thank you very much, and please continue discussing. We will be looking for comments and ways of interacting with the stakeholders as much as possible. Thank you very much.